Greetings. Will you make a video about this Muslim claim? Thank you, brother, for this question. Ordinarily, I read the Muslim point in full first and then dismantle it. But in this case, I think I should teach the truth as I present each point as appropriate. The truth is the important thing to know. There are an infinite number of Satan's lies that do not matter once one knows the truth. I'll now destroy the kingpin of your faith, the Muslim taunted. The idea or concept of a kingpin is as follows: a person or thing that is essential to the success of an organization or operation. I think linchpin is also a correct term, so I will use the two interchangeably as I present the truth of this matter. In the case of Christianity, I believe the kingpin this jihadi refers to is the death by crucifixion. But first, never hate sincere Muslims, even those who wage jihad by attacking the linchpin. I won't dwell on it in this video, but who is the enemy of our Christian faith? Who wants to deny the linchpin of the gospel of salvation? Who was embarrassed by the crucifixion and resurrection? And who profits from contradicting and subverting the gospel of Jesus? Just keep that percolating in your thinking. So what is the kingpin or linchpin of Christianity? As a Christian, it is very important to understand what you believe and why. And as a Christian, it is nearly impossible to isolate only one fact upon which all of Christianity stands. A linchpin or kingpin implies everything hangs upon it. Destroy the linchpin and the whole structure is fatally weakened. This is honestly one of the few logical and rational things Muslims ever do: try to attack the kingpin. In fact, all of Islam could be boiled down to three attacks against the message of Christianity. Jesus is not God come in the flesh. Jesus did not die on the cross as the sacrificed Lamb of God. Jesus was not raised from the dead. Therefore, God has not redeemed mankind as he said, and is thus a liar. That is Satan's Islamic deception in a nutshell. Second, recognize that what a Muslim attacks proves what they think the foundation of Christianity is. And I think they know because Satan knows his greatest humiliation. Colossians 2:15, and having disarmed the rulers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. A public spectacle is a humiliation in front of all those witnessing it. The heavenly hosts all saw Satan defeated. So, without question, the crucifixion was important. The death and the means of death were foretold by the prophets, who Satan and Islam hate and ignore. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, from the words of my groaning? Do those words sound familiar? My God, why have you forsaken me? These words are very familiar to Christians. But most do not know they come from Psalms 22:1. My God, why have you forsaken me? On the cross, Jesus quotes Prophet David. Jesus is applying this prophecy to himself. The Jewish prophets foretold of the suffering of God's servant, meaning the Messiah. But as for me, I am only a worm and not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by people. Isaiah 53:3, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me, they wag their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let him, God, deliver him. Let him, God, rescue him, for he delights in him. Matthew 27:43. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants him, for he said, I am the Son of God. Dear brother, realize Prophet David foretold the very mocking Jesus would hear from the cross. The prophets revealed details of the death that Messiah would die. For dogs have surrounded me. A gang of evildoers has closed in on me. They pierced my hands and my feet. Messiah hanging on the cross of crucifixion fulfilled the prophecies told of what Messiah would suffer. This includes suffering to the death for the sins of Israel and all mankind. Daniel 9:26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. Cut off means to be killed, meaning death. Not for himself means he is killed for others. Isaiah 53:8. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living for the transgression of my people to whom the stroke was due? Messiah was to be killed for the sins of God's people. This is what the prophets revealed hundreds of years before Yeshua came. John 3:14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, thus it behooves the Son of Man to be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. John 12:32. And I, this is Jesus speaking, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. He said this to signify the kind of death he was going to die. Lifted up, crucified. So Jesus taught he would die. And Jesus taught how he would die. But his death, while foretold, was only half of the story. The other half is the promise of resurrection. Jesus tried to teach his disciples that he would rise from the dead. Matthew 16:21. From that time Jesus began to show to his disciples that it is necessary for him to go away to Jerusalem and to suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and to be killed, and to be raised on the third day. And after another event, a vision which had occurred, Jesus said this. Matthew 17:9. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus instructed them, "Do not tell anyone about this vision until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." Raised from the dead first necessarily assumes death, being among the dead. But that is such a hard concept to understand, harder yet to believe. Matthew 20:18. Look, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and scribes. They will condemn him to death, and will deliver him to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and on the third day he will be raised to life. Notice, Jesus does not need to say, die. When Jesus said crucified, he said it already. Crucifixion means hung until dead. Jesus had to repeat the information for the disciples. That is, three times Jesus taught he would die and rise from the dead. That is such a hard concept to understand, and harder yet to believe. And still the disciples, bless their hearts, still did not fully and clearly understand. John 28, this is after the resurrection. Then the other disciple, whom had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw, and believed. For they still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. This means the scriptures revealed Messiah would rise from the dead. For they still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. It takes the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to fully understand the scriptures. John 16:12, I still have much to tell you, but you cannot yet bear to hear it. However, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. Jesus not only foretold his death, but that he would rise from the dead on the third day. Luke 24:46, and he told them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. Notice Jesus said, it is written. Now I've got to be totally honest, because I've looked and cannot find exactly where this is clearly written. About the best reference I find is Hosea 6:2. He will revive us after 2 days. He will raise us up on the third day, that we may live before him. And I know, this does not specifically say Messiah, does it? And it does not contain individual terms, but plural terms, as if referring to the nation of Israel. The case can also be made that this speaks of Israel's blindness for 2 days, or 2,000 years, and that the third millennium will soon witness Israel's elevation to its ultimate role. So, at best, this is a weak link because of the terms 3 days and raise up. He will revive us after 2 days. He will raise us up on the third day. But Jesus clearly stated that his resurrection after 3 days was a fact knowable from the scriptures. And he told them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. This was reaffirmed in the writings of the Apostle Paul. 1 Corinthians 15:3, for what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, according to the scriptures. One additional possible revelation is the following. Prophet David revealed another clue which must be carefully considered. Psalm 16:10, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, that's David speaking, nor will you allow your Holy One to undergo decay. Prophet David revealed God would not allow the Messiah to undergo decay, meaning his body to rot in the grave. And from the episode with Lazarus, we know that after a time the body stinketh, a sign of rot and decay. John 11:39, take away the stone, Jesus said. Lord, by now he stinks, said Martha, the sister of the dead man. It has already been 4 days. So by 4 days, the Messiah would have begun to rot and decay and stink. One could logically infer this implies an upper limit as to how long Messiah could remain dead. The Messiah would not, could not stay in the grave 4 days. And having taught and established his death and how he would die, and having referenced that scriptures said he would rise from the dead after 3 days, at one point Jesus was taunted and challenged for another sign. Luke 11:29, as the crowds were increasing, Jesus said, "This is a wicked generation. It demands a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites, so the Son of Man will be a sign to this generation." Luke 12:39. But he answered and said unto them, "An evil and adulterous generation craves for a sign, and yet no sign will be given to it but the sign of Jonah the prophet. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster," or the whale, "so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. And those who do not wish to hear and understand ignore the written words." And this is what seems to make it hard to answer unbelievers and those willfully deceived. The death and manner of death are established fact, clear to all who wish to see the truth. But Satan wishes to deny the facts and events he was ignorant and impotent to stop. So the sign which Jesus meant is twisted into a deception by Satan and repeated by those who submit to him as Allah. Jesus must have been as Jonah was in the whale. As and like are two words with as much wiggle room as is has. And those who live by deception love to hide behind what as means, or what like means, or what the definition of is. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Islam is afraid to see any word except as. Jesus must have been as Jonah was in the whale. The scripture does not make a single hint that the condition of Jonah mattered. Was Jonah standing up or laying down in the whale? It would be foolish to think the sign was that Jesus laid down in the grave. But when you retard your thinking to "as Jonah was" and stop there, you pretty much damn your thinking to such erroneous nonsense. Was Jonah dry or wet in the whale? I'd go all in on Jonah being wet, with water or digestive fluids. But I don't think Jesus was doused down with water, or worse, digestive fluids in the grave. Was Jonah repentant in the whale? Now that might actually make sense, in a way. Jonah ran away so that Nineveh would not repent. But I think Jonah saw the light before he saw daylight again. But Jesus did not run away, did he? What would Jesus have to be repentant for? Was Jonah wrapped in burial cloth? No, Jonah was in the clothes he had on when the crew tossed him overboard. Jesus had been stripped and wrapped in burial cloth. So many foolish distractions and deceptions to follow, just to dodge, deny, and ignore the historical fact Jesus died. The scripture does not make a single hint that the condition of Jonah mattered, because the condition does not matter. The death was foretold and the duration was affirmed. The sign is the duration, not the condition. But those with an agenda against the truth will hold fast to the lie that supports Satan's denial. The Muslim continues, I know you'll never say it, so I've to tell you. Simple. Sign of Jonah was he was alive and didn't die in the belly of the fish. See what I mean? Satan's jihad of distraction and additions around the word as, and in this case, the alive gambit. Satan's silly logic is, if I can argue that Jonah was alive, then I can try to argue Jesus must have been alive too. And if Jesus was alive, ignoring this whole grave thing, ignoring what the prophets said, ignoring what Jesus himself said, if the incoherent argument can be foisted that Jesus was really alive, then the linchpin of Christianity is destroyed. But the irrefutable weight of Scripture and history is that Jesus died. The alive gambit is about as intellectually bankrupt as claiming Jesus was a Muslim before Muhammad invented Islam. In fact, the resurrection proved Jesus was who he claimed to be. Romans 1:4, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. Acts 26:22, to this day I have had this help that comes from God, and so I stand here testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass. Paul taught nothing but what the prophets had already revealed, that Christ would suffer. As first through resurrection from the dead, he is about to preach light both to our people and to the Gentiles. But there are those who reject truth to follow one man alone. Then Abraham said to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be persuaded even if someone rises from the dead. Abraham has nailed the situation of those who reject truth. Okay, so over and over, the message Jesus tells the believers who follow him, he will die, be dead, then be raised from the dead. Details of death, body buried, goes into tomb or grave. So death was never doubted. What is and has always been Satan's jihad? Has God said? Denying the word of God. The alive gambit is just another deceptive thread in Satan's web of lies to condemn sincere but trusting souls. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is risen from the dead, the firstborn of many brethren. Amen.